Expected credit losses, in short known as ECL, under IFRS 9 financial instruments. Hi guys, in this lecture we'll discuss about ECL, expected credit loss model, under IFRS 9. Majority of the students find this concept very difficult because they are not able to understand and comprehend the concept with respect to credit risk and credit losses. So I'll try to break it down into bits and pieces so that you'll get the complete clarity after this lecture. I promise you that once you finish this lecture, you'll be 100% sure about what exactly are expected credit losses and how to deal with that, right? So with that being said, first let's understand what is credit risk. This is very important for you to understand. Without this, you will not be able to, get the concept of expected credit losses. Now, what do we mean by credit risk? In simple language, the risk that borrower might not pay back. What is it? The risk that the borrower might not pay back. So what does that mean? Let's say Bank A has given a loan to Mr. X. Now, if Mr. X repays the loan to the Bank A, no problem. If Mr. X, what he did is, he took that loan and he invested in a business, and that business ran into losses. Now, Mr. X cannot repay the loan. Now, this is called as a credit risk for Bank A. In short, credit risk is nothing but the risk that the borrower might not be repaying your company. Okay. Now, with that being said, what exactly is the credit loss model, sir? Expected credit losses, ECL model. ECL model states that you have to recognize a provision or an allowance for the expected losses. Create allowance for expected losses. As simple as that. Very short, very clear, very simple. Create a provision or an allowance for the expected loss. Now, I have given a loan of $10,000 to Mr. A, and I am worried that he will not be able to repay me the entire $10,000. He will only pay me $8,000. Now, in this particular case, I have to create an allowance for the loss, expected loss of $2,000. As simple as that. But sir, if it is that simple, then why are students getting confused? Because there are actually three stages under which the loss allowance has to be created, and that is where the students get completely confused. So I'll make it very simple for you. The first stage is where the credit risk, listen to me very carefully, ma, the credit risk did not increase significantly. The credit risk has not increased significantly. And the second possible situation is where, and second one is where, credit risk has significantly increased. Now you might be asking me, sir, what do we mean by, we know what is credit risk, but what do we mean by significant increase in the credit risk? Unfortunately, IFRS 9 does not define what is a significant increase. Okay, credit risk will always be there. No matter what kind of entity it is, there will always be a credit risk. See, even the best of the best people might not be able to repay their loans at a point of time. They might make a default in installment, interest payment or something at some point down the lane. Maybe possible. So there is always a credit risk, but it is said to be significantly increased when there are both quantitative and qualitative factors which endanger or create a sense of non-payment for the lender. For example, I have given a loan to Mr. X. Now, Mr. X is seen spending this amount recklessly, or he is seen that he is investing in XYZ businesses and they are running into losses. Now, I know that for a fact, I know that this guy will not be able to repay me my money. Then I can say that the risk has increased significantly. The credit risk has increased significantly. And there are quantitative and qualitative factors. For example, if I lent money to a company, okay, So the company's quantitative factors could be decrease in the profit ratios, profitability ratios, decrease in the annual cash flows. The free cash flows available for shareholders are decreasing every period. The share price in the market is declining. Number of contracts with customers are declining. These are all quantitative factors. Qualitative factors could be management is changing. There are fraud and other investigations happening on the company. Okay, or else the internal control systems are very weak and thereby there is a embezzlement of funds, which are seen very frequently. The assets are overstated. So many kinds of qualitative factors could be there. Okay, so there is no standard definition for significant increase in the credit risk. Don't worry, in your examination, they will tell you the credit risk has significantly increased from the initial recognition or inception of the contract. Or they'll state that the credit risk has not increased significantly since the inception of the contract. So they will very clearly specify whether it is increased or did not increase. So you don't need to worry about that, how to determine that. It is a very tricky question. The Big Four, EY, PwC, KPMG, these organizations are creating various, debate sessions, or I can state that they are giving explanation documents in their LMSs, respective LMS. For how to determine whether there is significant increase in credit risk or not. So it is not a factor which is examinable for SBR students, so don't worry. They'll tell you in the question significantly increased or significantly not increased. Okay, so this is called as a stage one. What is it called? Where the credit risk has not increased significantly, it is called as a stage one. So when an instrument is in stage one, you have to create credit loss allowance, you have to create ECL allowance. But what you will do is, you will create only 12 months expected allowance, 12 months expected losses. And many students, 99% of the students, they assume that 12 months expected means whatever losses are expected in the next 12 months, for that we create an allowance. That's absolutely wrong, my dear friends. No. Lifetime expected losses over the next 3, 4, 5, 6 years, over the lifespan of that instrument. For example, I have taken a loan from a bank, repayable in 5 years installments. So over the next 5 years, what will be the total default multiplied by probability of the default in the next 12 months? What are the chances of the default in the next 12 months? That is only to be created as an ECL allowance under IFRS 9. Okay, so 12 months expected losses means not next 12 months losses, it is lifetime losses multiplied by probability in the next 12 months. We will see a question, don't worry, I'll give you the complete picture with numbers, don't worry. Okay, I hope this concept is clear for you guys. Okay, next one is where credit risk has increased significantly. Again, there are two types of situation. One is stage 2 and the other one is stage 3. Stage 2 is where credit impairment is not there. Okay, not credit impaired. And the second one is credit impaired. So now what do we mean by credit impairment? In simple language, credit impairment means where it is a definitive proof. What is it? There is a definitive proof that there will be definitely losses. Okay, credit impaired means I for sure know that. For sure I know that this guy will not be able to repay me. 100% surety, not 100%. But there is an absolute assurance or very clear surety or perfect picture that no chances of him repaying, unless something wonder happens or there is a structural change happening, we will not be able to recollect the amount from that particular borrower. So that is called as a credit impairment. Okay, as you can see on your screen, impaired credit or credit impairment occurs when there has been a deterioration in the credit worthiness of an individual or an entity. Deterioration means we know for sure that he will not be able to repay, maybe not the entire amount. I am not talking about the amount. I am talking about he will not be able to repay. Whether completely he will not pay or will he pay partial and he will not pay partial, I don't know. But there are high chances that he will not repay me. This is usually reflected through a lower credit scores. As you know, there are ratings, credit ratings, CIBIL ratings, etc. A+, AAA, BB, BBB, all that ratings will be there. in this case of an individual, or a reduction in the credit rating assigned to an entity, or debt issued by rating agency or the lenders, like bonds issued will have credit ratings and all. So this is again a topic for AFM and FM, so I'm not going to discuss much about that. Okay, so if at all, this is also, again I'm telling you guys, this also will be mentioned in the question. Significant credit risk has increased significantly and there is no impairment. Okay, there is no credit impairment, that is called a stage 2. So if you are in the stage 2 situation, what you will do is you will create lifetime expected losses. Lifetime expected losses will be the loss allowance or ECL. Okay, here ECL, expected credit loss allowance, will be next 12 months. Here ECL will be lifetime expected loss. Sir, then what about stage 3? Stage 3 also lifetime expected loss. ECL is equal to lifetime expected losses. Sir, this is confusing. Then what is the difference between credit impairment is not there and when there is a credit impairment? Okay, stick with me, stick with me. This is the important point. Interest revenue will be there, na? Interest revenue here on gross amount. Gross amount, that is before ECL. Okay, sir, what does that mean? See, for example, I have lent $10,000. $2,000 worth of ECL is required. $2,000 worth of ECL is required. Now, what I'll do is, if there is no credit impairment, if the credit risk has not increased significantly, I'll create 2,000 of loss allowance. Net amount of loan, net amount of the financial asset will be 8,000, but interest will be calculated on the 10,000. Interest will be calculated on the gross amount, not the net amount of the provision. Similarly, here also, interest will be calculated on gross. Interest on gross amount, that is before ECL. Before ECL. But here, if there is a credit impairment, then interest on net amount. This is the major difference. Okay. After deducting ECL. So in this case, on 8,000 only interest will be calculated. Okay. So very quickly close your eyes once and recap with me. So credit risk means risk of non-payment. So IFRS 9 state that when there is a credit risk, you have to create a loss allowance. So there are two types of situations. One is where credit risk has significantly increased from the date of inception. Second one is where credit risk has not increased significantly since the date of inception. If the credit risk has not increased significantly, then 12 months expected losses provision will be created. So that will be calculated as lifetime losses into probability of the default in the next 12 months. If the credit risk has increased significantly, then again we have to check whether it is credit impaired or not credit impaired. If it is credit, if it is not credit impaired, if there is no credit impairment, then lifetime expected losses allowance will be created for that, but interest will be recognized on the gross amount. If there is a credit impairment, then interest will be recognized only on the net amount. Done with this chart? Clear? So let's see a question and we will wind up this lecture. Okay. So here is your stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3 impairment model or expected credit loss model of IFRS 9. So stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, as I have already discussed, I am not going to read it again. So look at this question. So this should give you the complete picture. So with this, you should be able to get the complete clarity. So on 1st Jan 2016, Lunar Company granted Skyzer Company a $5 million secured loan repayable on 31st December 2019. That means 16, 17, 18, 19, 4 years, with an interest of 3% payable annually at the reporting date. So 3% interest is payable. Okay. So on 31st December 2016, there has been no increase in the credit risk. Credit risk has not increased significantly and the probability of default in the next 12 months is 5%. Very good. The present value of the cash shortfalls expected over the life of the instrument if the default occurs in the next 12 months is 200,000. So lifetime expected credit losses are 200,000. Probability of that happening is 5%. Significant increase in credit risk is not there. So 200,000 into 5%, that is $10,000 worth of credit risk is there. That is the loss allowance that need to be created. So the total loan balance will be 5 million plus 3% interest minus 10,000 of loss allowance removed. And interest will still be calculated on 5 million into 3%, as I have said. Interest will be on 5 million into 3%. That is 150,000 interest will be calculated and recognized as revenue. And next one, second scenario, where on 31st December 2017, that means after one more year, the credit risk of the loan has increased significantly. The probability of the default occurring over the remaining life of the loan is 45%. The present value of ECLs from the default event over the life of the loan are expected to be 400,000. Okay, so credit risk has increased significantly, but no mention of credit impairment is there. There is no mention of credit impairment. So what we'll do, lifetime expected losses, interest will be still on the gross amount, right? So you can see here, ECL will be lifetime ECL, that is 400,000 into 45%. 400 into 45, that is 180,000. And the change of 170,000 in the cumulative impairment allowance. Sir, how 170? So total allowance required is 180. Already in the first year, you have created an allowance of 10,000. So increase in allowance, extra allowance required is 170,000 is the cumulative impairment is now recognized in the profit and loss. Interest will still be on the 5 million into 3%. This is more important. 5 million into 3%, 150. Interest will still be on the total amount. Look at the third scenario. Now we have a total impairment loss of allowance of 180,000, 10 plus 170. Third year, on 31st December 2018, the loan is credit impaired. They mentioned credit impairment. The present value that is expected to be recovered is 4 million. See, how much did we give? We gave a loan of 5 million, but now we are expecting to recover only 4 million. That means what is the loss? Total expected loss is 1 million. The gross carrying amount of the loan is 5,150,000, which is the loan plus unpaid interest for the year. Okay, in our books, we are showing the carrying amount of the loan is 5.15 million. We will be able to recover only 4 million. So what is the loss? 5.15 minus 4, 1.15 million will be the total loss. See here, lifetime ECL is 1.15 million, out of which we already have 180,000 in the provision. So 1.15 minus 0.18, that is 970,000 of new provision is required, which will be shown in the P&L. Look at this, this is more important. Interest for 2018 will be 153% of 5 million. This is 2018, last year, which is already completed. Impairment will be for the next period. Current period interest is already recognized. Next period, we will record on the net amount. So in 2019, interest revenue will be 3% of only 4 million, because now it is impaired. Now carrying amount will be only 4 million. On that 3%, 120 will be the fourth year's interest. First year 150, second year 150, third year 150, third year ending there was credit impairment identified. So fourth year we will recognize only 120,000 as the revenue, okay, which is the based on gross carrying amount, that is 5.15 minus impairment loss of 1.15. So on 4 million, we'll calculate the interest amount. Okay. So before winding up, there is one small point that I need to tell you. For trade receivables and contract assets, what's it? For trade receivables and contract assets, you know, we don't need to worry about all this nonsense like 12 months, lifetime, blah, 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 blah. We'll straight away follow with the 12 months concept. Look at this. For trade receivables or contract assets that do not have any significant financing component, IFRS 15, revenue from customers, there we have already covered what is significant financing component. So I'm not going to discuss again here. So the loss allowance should be measured at initial recognition and throughout the life of the receivable at an amount equal to the lifetime ECL. The concept of 12 months and all will not apply. We will always go with the lifetime ECL. In simple language, if you go back to your childhood, what you have done? So total receivables are 100,000. 10% of that is expected to be doubtful. So 100,000 into 10%, 10,000 is the provision. You did not consider all these risk allowances, credit impairments and all. So the same relaxation is given under IFRS 9 as well, where for trade receivables and contract assets that do not have significant financing component, a credit loss will be created on the basis of lifetime expected losses. A 12 months model will not apply. Okay. So now see here, as an exception to the general model, if the credit risk of a financial instrument is low at the reporting date, management can measure impairment using 12-month CCL, and so it does not have to assess whether a significant increase in credit risk has occurred. Sir, what does this mean now? If the management wants to go, if the management feels like, no, if I create complete lifetime allowances, the provisions will increase, my profit will be diluted. There is no risk as such. The credit risk has not significantly increased. I want to provide 12 months expected losses. Accepted. No problem. If the management wants to voluntarily choose the 12 months expected losses model, then absolutely yes, they can choose that. But usually for trade receivables, we will go with lifetime expected losses. If you want to switch to 12 months, absolutely possible. Yes, no issue. Okay. That is why it is given as an exception to the general model. If the credit risk of the financial instrument is low, management can measure, not should measure, management can measure the impairment using the 12 months ECL. Okay. With that, I'll wind up this lecture on the ECL and credit impairment. I hope this concept is very clear for you guys now, and I hope that you guys will not have any issues in the examination. So with that being said, I'll wind up. So keep smiling, take care, stay healthy, stay safe, and all the best for your exams. Bye-bye, guys.